Tom Matthews back again with a part two on this Keith Lee 617 electrometer. On the part one video, I showed one of the Teraohm relays that I replaced, and that made a big difference, made it go from not working at all to working on all but the most sensitive ranges, but it still wasn't right. I wanted to calibrate the unit, but I didn't want to proceed until it was, you know, working right on all ranges, including the, picoamp and femtoamp ranges, as well as it's supposed to go up to, above 250 gigohms measurements. So I wanted all that to work. And so in the last video I showed, I changed one of the relays. And it turned out some of these Teraohm relays some of the other ones were also bad. Let me show you what I changed here. These are the relays that were in here. And those are supposed to be Teraohm relays. It turned out that all of them are, in the gigaohm range now, which, for most applications, that would be a non-issue. And if a relay drifted like that, wouldn't be a big deal, but for this application it really matters. So I found these Kodo relays. You can't get these anymore. Kodo 7301-05-1000, which is guaranteed to be at least a teraohm. And I originally replaced K307 in the previous video, and it turned out I measured all of these after the fact. And if you look at this, K307 was terrible. It was about 700 megaohms. And that's, of course, why it made such a big difference. But these other relays that were in the circuit were also trouble causers. K309, 310, and 312 were the ones that really mattered as far as making the picoamp range work. But since I was in here, I went ahead and changed them all. And I'm glad I did. And then after I changed them all, I got it working really well, and I was able to use this instrument to measure the relays that were removed. So that was kind of fun, and that's how I got these measurements. But I also measured one of the brand new relays that I'm putting in there, and they measure, off the scale. I think that means at least 250 gigaohms. They're supposed to be a teraohm or more. I suspect they're quite a bit higher than that. So what else did I do? I think that, why did these fail? I think a lot of people that have these instruments are probably having the same trouble with these teraohm relays are failing. They're not really failed, they're just not teraohm anymore. So most applications that wouldn't matter. But I think what happens is maybe over time the glass vacuum leaks. No vacuum glass container can last forever. There's always gas leaks in through the glass, especially hydrogen atoms can migrate through glass. So I don't know if that's what the phenomenon is here, but this is a pretty old instrument, so you can't expect that relays to last forever. So I changed all of those. Some of the other things I did here, after I changed those, I put in a circuit. It was working pretty good, but I thought, I found there's a dual FET in here, Q308, that is the core of how this thing works. And it was pretty good in its day. It was probably 100 femtoamp type offset current. But a fellow on the internet on EEV blog, Alex Nitikin, posted this circuit that uses a National Semiconductor LMC662AIM, which is a 3 femtoamp op amp. And he replaces that dual JFET with an op amp circuit that mimics the JFET. The 18K resistors mimic the transconductance of the JFET. And the more I looked at this circuit, the more I thought, wow, that is a really good idea, and I couldn't see any reason why this is going to cause trouble. Actually, it turns out it makes it work even better and updates this instrument to modern performance level. So I put that in, and it works fabulously. The other nice thing about this is this op amp has its own protection on the input pins. There's ESD protection diodes on the pins, so it's also able to remove Q311 protection, double diode protection in there, and I removed that, which should also improve your leakage current, because that thing probably leaks a little bit, not much, but since you don't need it, it's still, you know, why not take it out of there? Okay, so I got it all working pretty well. Right now it's measuring a 100 gig ohm resistor, and you can see it's within 1%. It's a 1% gig ohm resistor, so it should be between 99 and 101. If I close this up and let it sit for a long time, it will settle. Last night it settled down to 100.03 or something like that, so it's quite accurate now, and I'm delighted with the performance. I did, once I got everything working properly, I wanted to calibrate it, and I could not get this to accept a calibration, and I decided that this there's a 256-bit non-volatile RAM in here that is made by Zycor, an X24C44P, and it's U104. It's pretty old stuff. It's, you know, obsolete stuff. But I was decided that's probably not. It's supposed to be able to hold stuff in static RAM. It would hold in static RAM, but it wouldn't transfer to the non-volatile. Every time I'd try to save the calibration, it wouldn't save. So fortunately, I found some of those ICs, you know, on the web from a dealer that had some new old stock of those. And I put that in, and it will hold the cal now. The other thing to watch out for when you're calibrating these, there's a jumper back here that has to be in the calibration position to allow the calibration. You can cal these from the front panel. When you read the manual, it looks like you might need a GPIB program. You don't have to have that. It's pretty easy to calibrate these. The other thing to watch out for is it will only calibrate on certain ranges. So one of the things that confused me when I first started trying to cal it is I would try to cal on the wrong range, and it'll act like, you know, it didn't work. So be careful. You have to have the exact number of decimal points on the display that the manual calls for when you're calibrating those. So, but you can see I replaced all the relays here with the new Kodos. Much better performance. I washed the board with some laboratory grade methanol in a airbrush gun, and so that to get any contaminants off there. I have the cover off now because just to show you guys what's going on in here, but I'm very happy with this instrument. Pretty neat piece of gear, and it did calibrate nicely. I also went to, since I realized it was going to work, I splurged and bought another cable, another Triax cable. This is a Pomona 5054-36, and then I bought a couple of these. These are not cheap. This is the triaxial, I think that's a BJ77TL triaxial connector, and I used it to make this test box. So that 100 gig ohm resistor's in there, I can put the lid on it. What the test box does is it lets that guard voltage come out here and surround the resistor, so there's no way that it helps prevent leak currents from getting into the test fixture. I'll let you guys take a little look in there. I got a couple banana jacks on here, a grounding plug. I even put a 0.01 microfarad high voltage cap across one of the ports, because some of the tests you do, you want to bring voltage in here, and that lets you have cut some of the noise off. I had to this connector, you know, needs to be insulated from the box, because depending on what kind of test you're doing, you either want that connected to the box or you want the box connected to the guard. And so in here I can connect the guard to the box ground, but that's just using some phenolic in there. One of my friends that came over said, oh, you should have used Teflon. It doesn't matter here. It doesn't matter if there's a leak there, and of course phenolic is pretty good. But even if there is a leak there, the guard drive is a low Z circuit, and it's not part of the measurement affair, so a leak there wouldn't hurt. What I'm going to do next is button this up, and then I'm going to put it on the look at the femto amps, and I've got a pretty cool Esterline Angus chart recorder over here, so I'm going to put the output of that on the chart recorder,
and see how stable I am. I think I'm, that op amp's supposed to be 3 femtoamps, and what I was watching, it looked like it's gonna be accurate within 3 femtoamps, which is fabulous. When I worked for National Semiconductor, we used to say a femtoamp is 6,280 electrons per second. So really almost down to the quantum level on this type of instrument. Anyhow, I hope this is helpful. And thanks to everybody on EEV blog for their input. Very helpful to me in getting this working right. And I'll be excited to add this instrument to my collection. Thanks, eBay.